Trevor is going to do a short introduction, and Alex is going to be showing Linux running on the Amiga X5000. Linux running on the Amiga X5000, shown here in public for the second or third time, with a brief introduction by Trevor. So feel free to filter your way in. You'll get a chance to see the X5000 boot, as well as a short demonstration of what Linux can do on the system. Thank you.
Hello. Okay. I'm just going to introduce Alex Perez. Alex is a very experienced Linux developer. He's also in the core Linux team for the X5000 beta test program. It's a Hyperion Entertainment policy not to show Amiga OS 4 in beta format being run on new hardware. Obviously, people have seen it at the show, but in live demonstration on video, can't show that. And I can understand the reason for that. Alex has been pushing the envelope on the Linux install on the X5000. If you saw my presentation yesterday, you would have seen Dan and Stephen's installation of Linux on the X5000, running SuperTux cart, you know, testing all the 3D hardware acceleration, video, etc. Alex looks at the more bleeding edge part of Linux and likes to really push the envelope. So his installation is somewhat different, but nevertheless not very interesting. So he'll give you some of the ideas about the hardware and what he's running. So I'm going to move it over to Alex and leave it to him. Thank you.
So one of the things we're going to show briefly is just a full system boot up on the X5000 from power off all the way up to a booted OS. And just to kind of give people an idea of the speed of the system and what U-boot actually looks like in its current form. Obviously, all of this is very much a work in progress. And, you know, frankly, today I'd hope to show significantly more, but I've run into a number of software roadblocks that are a result of me tinkering with my system continuously. So, without further ado, we'll power this guy up. And U-boot will come up here, and then I will break into it and just tell it to boot Linux. The work that I've been doing on Linux is primarily focused around ensuring that the processor in the X5000 is fully supported under Linux. There's a number of code drops that Freescale, the manufacturer of the part, has provided. But a lot of that isn't in the upstream Linux kernel, which is what makes it easy to support long-term. So that work is being, see, I get distracted. I'm gonna press restart, ready reset here. That work is being done by people both from Freescale actively and people from Canonical and as well as Christian, who's filed a number of bugs and ensured that people are aware that this sort of code needs to be PowerPC specific fixes need to be made to certain core system libraries. All right, so we're going to break in here. We're going to choose. Yeah, we don't have any video. Do you want to switch to this camera really quickly? Because until I'm in Linux, we don't have anything on the projector. All right, I'm going to reset yet again so you can see it. And as I was saying, there's a lot of behind-the-scenes work that needs to be done to make it so that we don't need to use hand-compiled kernels to boot this machine. And I've probably compiled 70 or 80 variants of kernels with various levels of patches over the last few after the last month or so, but the ultimate goal is to be able to boot a stock PowerPC Linux variant from Ubuntu with no patches required, and And that's what we're working towards. So now we've got it up on the projector here, and we can hop over there. And since I spend a lot of time at the console, I've got this booting in text mode here. X is going to come up here. My current desktop environment is running LXDE, which is nice and lightweight. I'll go ahead and log in here. All right, so a little homage, and it's going to be a pretty basic walkthrough here. So we've got a dual-core machine, as you can see, sitting here idle. We've got a bunch of processes open in the background because, after all, it is Linux. Load is quite low, though. And we can let me go ahead and fire up system details here and show you what is going on under the covers. What we currently have been doing is a bunch of kernel level work, and that's not really very interesting to show. Also, this machine is currently on the LAN here at the conference, and the prepackaged web browser here, IceWeasel, is just a variant of Firefox. It's Firefox 31, and just to demonstrate that everything's working great here, we'll load up Amiga.org. There we go. Oh, look, it's Trevor. And this, my particular machine, has I have it configured with 8 gigabytes of RAM, and that's mostly to aid in speed and compilation as we compile things over and over and over again. If you don't have enough memory, you're really just wasting time. Currently right now in the desktop environment, this is not 3D accelerated at all. That is not working, and it's not working because of a software problem that actually I caused. This is a full 2D accelerated Radeon 6450, and I had SuperTux Cut running in 2D accelerated mode, and even now that is broken because of my tinkering. I need to roll back to a previous instance here. So if you look briefly at what we've got going on, I've got a couple of hard drives in here. Again, like I said, 8 gigs of RAM. Right now we're driving simultaneously out of this Radeon card into the projector as well as to my monitor here on the desktop. Double and triple view support is built in out of the box with the Radeon driver that's currently shipping under Linux. In terms of what I've been working on besides the kernel, a lot of the work that that Christian has done on the X14 Linux user land type stuff on the X1000 is equally usable on the 5000. And so some of his system libraries can be used without any change at all. And I've been experimenting with that, which is part of why I can't show you anything with accelerated 3D at the moment. the great thing about running Linux right now on the X5000 is it's rock stable. And so if we want to test and validate that the various hardware subsystems are working, we can do that. One of the things that I have not done that I look forward to doing is experimenting with the Zorro under Linux and attempting to come up with some useful functional uses for it. So again, you know, it's early days with Linux. Darren's demo video of the X5000 running SuperTux Cart shows the beginning of where we can go, but to fully utilize both cores right now and as much memory as you can afford to put in the machine, Linux is the way to go in the short term. So I'll open it up to questions. That's really all I intended to share. And if anyone has any questions about either Linux on Cyrus specifically on the X5000 or on PowerPC or the X1000 in general, feel free to ask.
Have you played around with virtual NICs at all?
I have not yet played around with virtual NICs. I have, though, played around with QEMU, and I actually had run the compiler for the XMOS chip under QEMU, which is an I386 binary, under QEMU on my X5000. And of course, it's slow, but if you just want to quickly compile something, you don't want to deal with moving things between machines, it is functional and it does work. There's hardware level virtualization that this chip provides, and in theory, there's nothing to prevent you from running an entirely different operating system and assigning it a single core from the machine, and being able to use the Linux base as a kind of petri dish, if you will, to do more focused work without having to constantly reboot your computer.
On the other virtualization problem, I'm looking into trying to see if you can use the KVM work that's been done for Power Linux.
Yes, the Power KVM work is equally usable here. The kernel that we're running right now has support for it, but again, the userland tools are the problem right now. KVM is the kernel level virtual machine, and it is the built-in virtualization layer that exists within Linux. So under Linux today, on commodity PC hardware, you can run Windows, you can run FreeBSD, you can run any operating system, Solaris, that you can think of, and it has a lot of significant industry support, both from IBM on the power side, as well as from organizations like Red Hat on the commodity server side of the industry. So it has uses across the board. For instance, on Christian's X1000, he has successfully run PowerPC OS 10 under Mac on Linux, which is indirectly making use of KVM through QEMU. So there are lots of opportunities there for experimentation if people want to try. It's actually nice to see some PowerPC support from Ubuntu out of the box. That's mostly thanks to the work that is being done in concert with IBM and their Power server lines. But virtualization is baked into the silicon of the X5000, and what we choose to do with it is up to us, really. Any other questions?
Mm-hmm.
No, and in fact, other than the kernel, which is machine specific, there's theoretically no reason at all why all of the work that's been done for the X1000 Ubuntu Live CD cannot be used wholesale with very minimal, if not zero, changes on the X5000.
Obviously, not here for all due respect, not here for Linux.
Understood.
We're obviously going to our schools and courses for us. However, I should say that it's correct that it has made that allow us to test all the components, hardware, and the Linux. Does that give us confidence that it works?
Yeah, I mean, I've pumped tens of gigabytes of data through the Ethernet interfaces on this machine. There are 2 gigabit Ethernet interfaces. I've run stress tests on the hardware for 24, 48 hours at a time. Stress tested the memory, both to validate that the DIMMs I had lying around worked properly, as well as to validate the system as a platform. And everything I've seen thus far is that this is a very well-engineered product, and it will live on for years to come. So,
what's your background, Alex?
Sure. My background is primarily in my professional life is historically has been as a Linux system administrator. I've worked for a series of both startups and large companies. Currently, I'm an employee of LinkedIn, and I came to LinkedIn by way of an acquisition that happened earlier this year. I've also worked with Bill Borsari at AMD, and they acquired a company that we had both mutually worked for that is now a fully fledged family within AMD. So the experience that I have really comes from a childhood desire to tinker. I got a hand-me-down 386 when I was a kid, and at that point I had a CD that I got out of the back of a Linux book that had Linux 0.9 on it. I think it was SLS, and it was quite primitive, but you know, given the hardware I was working with, it was all I needed. My interest in Linux just kind of blossomed from there. One of my early professional entrances into using it was at a small local dial-up ISP, back when those such things existed. And we had a bunch of Solaris machines that, frankly, the owner of the shop couldn't afford to add, purchase new and additional hardware as we continued to grow. And so we decided to offer web hosting and shell access on a much less expensive Pentium Pro machine running Linux. So I've been using Linux professionally since the mid-90s, and I find it's a very useful platform to test and validate hardware. My personal interest, I would love to see OS4 fully racing on this hardware. I think it's an excellent hardware, and I'm looking forward to the day that I can run nothing but OS4 on my Cyrus. But until then, I've got a great alternative, and then for anyone who wants to experiment with Linux on PowerPC hardware, it's a great platform to do that, especially given the performance characteristics of the machine and the fact that a Cyrus performs on par with a significantly older, less reliable hardware. So, any other questions? We good? All right. There we go. That's that.